And Don, of course, topmost priority for the visit, many assume, is security. Improving security ties between Japan and the Philippines. Now, specifically, are we looking at certain agreements that might be accepted by both parties, or that might come to fruition with this visit of Prime Minister Kishida?
Right. I think one of the things that is highly anticipated for this visit, and in fact, this visit may serve as a significant stepping stone for such an agreement, would be the Reciprocal Access Agreement, right, or the RAA, and which mm-hmm. Japan has with other countries as well, close countries. So, an RAA will improve, of course, the ability to operationalize our cooperative activities with Japan, from port calls to joint exercises, right, army to army relations as well. And this would also complement what we have with the United States, the VFA, our SVFA with Australia, and of course, it will be able to help us improve army-to-army relations and improve troop presence of Japan, and of course, keep it in line with our expanding defense partnerships with the United States, because as you all know, President Marcos Jr.'s current position lies in, of course, narrowing the functional gap of the hub-and-spoke system, right, between particularly the U.S., Japan, Australia, and the Philippines. So, of course, this is seen as a significant area of convergence, which would also provide more flexibility in the Philippines' position, right, in order to forward a more apt and robust defense partnership with like-minded democratic partners like Japan. And of course, we're also looking into potential areas of arms trade and technology transfers and anything mm-hmm. to do with operation based on technology with strategic purposes. I think there's a recent report on satellites that are being looked at, which the Philippines can procure. So, of course, this is in line with the unfolding and, of course, the developing partnership we have with Tokyo.
Let's unpack some of the things that you mentioned, Don, beginning with the RAA. We know that we have Japan has an RAA with the US and the UK. Now, the Philippines isn't going to be the first country in the Southeast Asian region that Japan is going to have an RAA with. And how significant is that if this deal pushes through?
Well, it's significant in both ways. From Japan's perspective, we can see that the importance attributed in Tokyo to Manila is growing. And in fact, mm-hmm. that though we have had great relations with Japan since the turn of the 21st century, what we can see now is an increasing momentum that is channeled by not only shared threat perceptions at the international level, but of course, a greater depth in our understanding at the policy-to-policy level between Manila and Tokyo. And of course, this is seen as an area of trust between two countries. And of course, you don't just have defense agreements out of the blue. It is based on and founded on mutual trust, mutual adherence to particular norms, values, and of course, goals. And this shows you that with the ability of the Philippines to be the first in Southeast Asia to have such an agreement with Japan, shows the importance we have in Japan's security calculations. And similarly, our idea of accommodating such an agreement, and of course, the fact that Prime Minister Kishida would be the sixth leader to speak in a joint session of Congress since 1960 also shows the importance we attribute to Japan as our robust strategic partner. So, of course, again, this is a time where like-mindedness plays a huge role in forging security and economic relations. And I believe that we are on that path to harness and leverage what we have right now.
Mm-hmm. Don, just to concretize these ideas about cooperation, will this mean that if the RAA pushes through, we will see Japanese troops participating in Balikatan exercises, and that we'll also see Filipino troops mm-hmm. going to Japan, for instance, for training?
Well, yeah, I mean, this would be a VFA of sorts, right? But of mm-hmm. course, it would have different characteristics. But in the end of the day, it's about increasing the presence of troops in a particular country. So, of course, as I've mentioned, this aligns well with the VFA and the SVFA we have in Australia. But of course, as for the nitty-gritty details in terms of, what to expect for the agreement, I think that we can only assume as of now, as early mm-hmm. as now, and will depend on the level of negotiations that would take place in the months to come. So we may see that agreement unfold during the visit. However, we may, of course, look at it as a stepping stone to furthering that agreement in the months to come. So either way, we are forging a positive some cooperation with Japan. It is a win-win definitely for both of us.
Don, let's talk about possible defense equipment. You touched on this earlier, and in NHK is reporting that part of the possible defense equipment that Japan or that the Philippines might acquire from Japan is the so-called maritime surveillance radar and offshore security assistance framework. Can you talk a bit more about this particular equipment or system that we might be procuring from Japan?
Right. And, you know, this comes at a time when China's gray zone activities continues to hamper not only our interests in the West Philippine Sea, but Japan's interest in the East China Seas as well. And from what we can see, Japan is also troubled with Chinese gray zone activities, right? And it's something that needs to be evolved as well based on Japan's bilateral treaty with the United States. So this is a this is an ongoing challenge that we both have in terms of gray zone activities. And gray zone activities often take place when a country is isolated, right? And this is something that such intelligence sharing, information sharing plays a vital role in aiding countries such as ours in order to better address gray zone activities that involve, you know, such measures, right? So, of course, sharing of intelligence and understanding the facts on the ground at a more comprehensive level, gaining from our trusted partners, you know, credible information and equipment that would help us in facilitating that goal would be crucial. You know, that would be a significant help. We also have a similar sort of agreement with Canada. Well, not really a similar one, but of course, something in line with intelligence sharing and addressing gray zone activities. You know, being able to tap on Canadian satellites to monitor rogue vessels. Right. So this is all towards that realization that we need to enhance that level of information and intelligence at a time when China's gray zone activities continues to hamper, you know, any sort of efficient, transparent levels of engagement in the Indo-Pacific region, its maritime domain.
And talk about Chinese aggression in the South China Sea, in the West Philippine Sea. Are you seeing potential talks of joint patrols between the Philippines and Japan with respect to this area?
Well, you know, I hope so, because, you know, it's very important for us to institutionalize and regularize our bilateral cooperation, our bilateral maritime exercises. Because the thing here is that consistency matters a lot, particularly when it comes to maritime security. And of course, overtly demonstrating our willingness to secure our sovereignty, sovereign rights, and territorial integrity. And Beijing, since the 1990s, has shown that it is willing to exploit any form of policy inconsistency that is present, right? So I've mentioned that we need to be consistent in our approach. So hopefully this could be an annual exercise or, you know, it has to be institutionalized. Because if you remember, in 2019, the Philippines had a first ever quad-like exercise with Japan, India, and the United States in the disputed maritime territory. But this was just a one-off, and that led to it being shrugged aside by China, right? So we do not want that level of complacency to be seen. You know, so we have to be, we have to illustrate that we are serious about this, that we are steadfast in defending our sovereignty, sovereign rights, and of course cooperating with like-minded partners that have similar interests at a time when Indo-Pacific maritime security continues to face significant fluctuations, right? So it's important. It's part of the signaling as well.
And Don, how do you think China will take this if such agreements will indeed be formalized in this visit of Prime Minister Kishida?
Yeah, I mean, you know, at the end of the day, China is expressing its dissatisfaction because, you know, based on its disinformation campaigns, it makes it seem that it is in Manila's best interest not to do anything about securing its sovereignty and sovereign rights, right? So, of course, it's anxious with the way that we are overtly now, you know, engaging in a way that reflects our interests, our sovereignty, sovereign rights, and territorial integrity. And in fact, China continues to bend the narrative, you know, making it seem that it's not in our best interest. You know, just recently, The Global Times published an article that says that, you know, Prime Minister Kishida's visit will eventually rile up the Philippines in the greater South China Sea. So it makes it seem as if, you know, the visit would be a bad thing for Philippine interests. But on the contrary, we are on the defensive. You know, we are defending what is rightfully ours without provoking the status quo. I think our position is quite clear. You know, we are basing it on international law, on clause of 2016 arbitral ruling. So we are doing everything in line with what is rightfully ours based on international law. And this is something that, of course, challenges the narrowly driven interests of China. So, you know, it's definitely going to get up some negative reactions in Beijing. But of course, we have to do what is necessary in order to preserve what is ours.
And Don, what's the bigger play here for Japan? Because we're seeing articles now like in South China Morning Post suggesting or raising the question, could Japan serve as a counterweight for China in this region? What's the likelihood of that?
Well, you know, it's actually quite interesting you ask that. You know, Japan's position as a partner of choice, not only in the Philippines, but in the entire Southeast Asian region, continues to improve. And in fact, if we look into the State of Southeast Asia survey, right, which is a very authoritative survey based on the ISAS Institute, right? It shows that the Philippines continues to choose Japan as a partner of choice, an alternative security and defense partner amidst the turbulence faced within the U.S.-China power competition. And it shows that we can operate with our partnership with Japan independently, right? So though it is under the umbrella of the hub and spoke system, it shows that we are very much willing to take this forward, you know, as an independent force of stability. And of course, Japan sees that as an opportunity as well, because Japan is also trying to cement its position in the Indo-Pacific as a reliable and important security and development partner. So again, it goes both ways.
And how significant is it, Don, that after this visit to Manila, the Prime Minister, the Japanese Prime Minister, is going to visit Malaysia, is going to meet with Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim. And there's also this talk about collaboration for the commemorative summit for the 50th year of the ASEAN-Japan friendship and cooperation in December this year. So you're saying Japan is trying to cement itself, its relationship in the Southeast Asian region, but also the question is, why only now?
Well, you know, I wouldn't say it's only now, because if you look at it economically speaking, Japan has been for the longest time the top investor in Southeast Asia. And on top of that, it is the largest investor, resident investor of the Indo-Pacific. So, of course, in line with this, we can see that Japan has been consistently engaging with Southeast Asia to the point that Southeast Asia recognizes the importance of Japan. I mean, it's undeniable. But now we can see that because of the geopolitical shifts that are taking place, Japan has been more overt in aligning its policy towards a more security-driven lens to facilitate, of course, the interests of its partners, particularly in Southeast Asia. Japan's Ministry of Foreign Affairs has also attributed a huge amount of money to build the capacity of like-minded partners in the region, and the Philippines is, of course, one of them. So we can see a more reinvigorated position by Japan, particularly in the security realm, right? And
Don, we seem to be having some problems with Don's audio. Let's continue our discussion with geopolitical analyst Don McLean. Gil, Don, before the break, you were talking about why Japan is now asserting itself more overtly. Talk to us about it.
Right, thank you. And just to pick up from the last points that I made, Japan has already been steadily making its presence known in Southeast Asia. It is a partner of choice, the largest investor in the region in terms of infrastructure. And of course, its role is undeniable between and among Southeast Asian countries. But today, you know, what we could see is a reinvigorated attempt by Japan and a reinvigorated posture, particularly in providing more robust frameworks for security and defense, right? And this is because Japan realizes that the security architecture of the Indo-Pacific continues to face significant shifts because of revisionist forces. And of course, being a major democratic Indo-Pacific country, it is necessary for Japan to play its role in maintaining the peace and stability. And this is, of course, one of the interests of the Southeast, Southeast Asian countries as well. The ASEAN outlook on the Indo-Pacific highly emphasizes on the need to maintain the rules-based order. And this is, of course, in line with Japan's interests as well. So now, of course, given that Japan has also attributed a huge chunk of its budget for the Foreign Affairs Ministry for capacity building, we can now see that Japan is playing a large role in building the capacities of like-minded partners such as the Philippines. So, of course, this comes at a time when we are facing with a lot of uncertainty, geopolitically speaking, and, of course, at a time when Japan is willing to take up a more robust role in the region.
And talk about the larger picture here, Don. We know that the U.S. is the biggest ally of the Philippines, but at the moment, we also know that it's fighting two wars, one in Ukraine, one in Gaza, although not directly, but there are a lot of concerns about the strain on the resources of the United States. How significant is it for Japan to step up as an ally at this point when there are concerns that the U.S. could not fight three or more wars?
Right, I agree with you. You know, it's quite difficult, even for the United States, the most powerful country in the world, to sustain a consistent level of presence, you know, in every part of the world. I think that's just practically speaking, right? Mm-hmm. But we have to understand Japan's role here is quite significant. Yes, some may view Japan as an extension of the U.S. alliance network, right? But it's also important to look at Japan's role as an autonomous force, right? An independent force of stability for the region. Japan is the only Asian G7 member. And as we can see from the recent summit that was held in Japan, Japan has endeavored, of course, to intertwine the mandate of the G7 to the security of the Indo-Pacific. So it's trying to be that position, you know, it's trying to be in that position that serves as a major pillar of the region. It's also an Indo-Pacific resident power. Right. So, of course, Japan's role is undeniable. And Japan's, as I mentioned, it is the largest investor, resident investor in the region as well. So I think there's no question commitment in facilitating that particular position in the region. But of course, it would be continued it would face challenges, of course, given that it also has multidimensional interests. But of course, the Indo-Pacific, you know, particularly Southeast and East Asia, lie at the heart of Japanese foreign policy. So I think that is the advantage that we have. The political will of Japan would definitely be consistent in this regard.
Mm-hmm. I want to understand, though, in terms of history of positioning in the ASEAN region, in the East Asian region, I want to understand the policy of Japan and why it's evolving now. Because in 1977, it did announce the Fukuda Doctrine here in Manila. It declared its resolve never again to become a military power and to strive to strengthen its relations with the nations of Southeast Asia. And of course, we know that that's part of the history of the role that it played in World War II. But are we seeing now a shift in terms of policy? Is Japan still sticking to the Fukuda Doctrine?
Right. I mean, that part is enshrined well in the Constitution of Japan to the point that, of course, there's also that domestic sentiment of not wanting to be more overtly militarily engaged throughout the world, right? I mean, that's another case, but we could see now there's a change in the norms surrounding Japan's engagements, right? Japan is also aware that in order to preserve its interests, it would need to play a larger security role. And, you know, it is trying to find a middle way between not compromising what is stated in the Constitution, but at the same time, being proactive enough to engage as a responsible security partner in the region, right? And this is where we can see Japan's role as a capacity builder. And at the same time, Japan can also realize that, you know, the situation in the East Asian region in particular has become too complex to the point that it is impossible not to involve the security realm of engagement, right? And it's only practical for major powers such as Japan to engage in that regard, right? However, as I've mentioned, that there's also that section in the Japanese domestic public, right, that also look at it as a sense of anxiety. But of course, the broader picture here is that Japan is not just trying to shift its position drastically. I think it's going to be a smooth transition based on what is taking place at the external level, right? But at the same time, it has to show its commitment. You know, it has to show its commitment at a time when the geopolitical dynamics of the region faces great uncertainty in the future, right? So it has to be proactive in that regard. So the question now is, how will it be able to balance both aspects, right? So we have, we have the constitutional aspect and, of course, the evolving norms surrounding Japanese engagement, right? We can look at it based on the evolution of that norm, and we can see how that norm will eventually take place and shift domestic perception as well. But this is definitely not an overnight scenario. It would depend on how the external forces play out in line with Japan's interests as well. So it's both, it's a balance between both external and internal factors when you talk about this.
And Don, you don't foresee any changes in this policy, even if there could be a change in the future in the leadership in Japan. We know that, unlike the Philippines, there could be some changes in a matter of years. 2-3 years in Japan, change in prime minister. You don't foresee any changes in the policy despite a possible change in leadership.
Right. I mean, if we talk about it based on the constitution, right, based on the legal documents, right, it would take a lot of time to reform, right? But there are obviously ways to express Tokyo's interest to play a larger role at the security realm without creating much of a fuss, in terms of that at the domestic level. We've seen it since Prime Minister Shinzo Abe. I mean, I told you, the Indo-Pacific construct was largely a brainchild of the former prime minister. And, Prime Minister Abe, since Prime Minister Abe, Japan's foreign policy began to largely shift towards a security-driven policy, right? But this should not be translated in a way that Japan is now revising its constitutional responsibilities and its position, right? I mean, there are obviously ways in which Japan would be able to express and demonstrate its willingness to play a larger role in the defense and security realm in a way that is also in line with its interests and its constitution, right? So it's obviously finding that balance that we see now. And, this has been taking place since Prime Minister Abe, right? So we could see that throughout the next prime ministers that took, that held power, that took, their particular positions in Japan, we could see that trend continue. Right. So I think we're looking into a smooth process, a smooth realization of the need to play a larger role in this regard. Right.
All right. We'll definitely watch out for that visit today of Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida. Thank you so much, geopolitical analyst Don McLean Gill, for sharing your thoughts and insights this morning on Head Start.
Thank you very much.